serious?
Kind of give me a wedgie. Like, am I good?
So we've got this cute little lemon number.
Yeah, it.
Oh no.
Oh, that is so funny.
How long have I had that?
Can you rub your pickle?
Are you joking? Roll or what?
I'm in here.
Come on.
One thing that you need to do is get out quickly, find someone, make contact, boom, boom, get into the end zone.
The You've Been Dreaming About This Car Since You Were 8 policy from American Family Insurance. You know how we come and come for nothing, not yet.
Avery Atkins will kick it off after LSU's first score of this game. Donovan Kaufman back to receive for Vandy. Good kick that time, and Kent Seals out once again to direct this Vanderbilt offense. From Azle, Texas, Red Steagle, big country western guy from Azle, out northwest to Fort Worth. I'm guessing he probably played once or twice in Nashville. Not a whole lot of live music going on these days. And some of those iconic music venues pretty empty, although there's some change coming tonight. We'll tell you about that a little bit later. Play action. Seals on the run. A little wobbler, but it's complete. A Vanderbilt first down. Chris Pierce for 19.
Now, I love the play call. Offensive coordinator Todd Fitch said he wanted to get more pass plays on first down. A hard play action. The outside zone was getting going their first drive a little bit. So play action off that and get Chris Pierce involved, the guy that they need to step up on the outside. He's got experience, but just 2 catches last week against Texas A&M. He's got to be more involved.
Yeah, they only returned 673 receiving yards from last year after missing Kalijah Lipscomb. Marlowe bottled up, no gain. So not only a new quarterback, but a bunch of new faces on the perimeter that need to step up this season for Vanderbilt. Todd Fitch is the new Vanderbilt offensive coordinator, 35-year college football veteran. Was at La Tech with Skip Holtz. We got flags on the play. And he's got a Vandy connection.
False start. Offense number 84. 5-yard penalty. It remains second down.
That's Justin Ball, the tight end. Product of Ohio Wesleyan. A couple of years after a guy by the name of Tim Corbin graduated from Ohio Wesleyan. Here's Marlowe again. Doing a lot to try and change direction on LSU. Stingley came up for the stop. Speaking of Tim Corbin, there's the facsimiles of the Vandy baseball team. Players past and present in the stands. Only students allowed in the stadium today.
I saw Dansby Swanson down there.
You think he'd be
Braves
busy?
Guy, an Atlanta guy.
We got a Dansby drop in for you later. Seals lets it go. And that's caught just shy of midfield. Pick up a 5 to Cam Johnson, junior from Brentwood.
Another guy they expected to have a little bit more of an impact. Obviously, week one with a true freshman quarterback, it's going to be all over the place. But Cam Johnson, Chris Pierce, they're going to end up being playmakers on the outside. So good to see them get involved early, but not enough there to get the first down.
Third punt of the night for Smith, who last year was sixth in the nation in punting yardage, 3,313 of them. That's not a stat you want to be in the top 10 of. 37-yard punt that time. While we have a break in the action, let's throw it to Laura Rutledge and our friends at Academy Sports and Outdoors.
Man, shopping at Academy is such an experience. It's like fun you didn't even know you needed. All over the place. It's everywhere. What?
Okay. Yep. Yeah. So help me if you want to. Brandon out of the shotgun. And an inside handoff to Price. And he finds four.
Been a calculated attack so far for LSU. Some perimeter throws, the run game has been going. That's when the play action starts to come into play. See if Steve Ensminger dials one up here. Might be play action from empty, but see if they take a shot.
Scott Linehan, the passing game coordinator this season for LSU. Brennan on the run. Here's Davis Price. And he picks up an LSU first down.
It looked like initially they wanted to push the ball downfield to the right, but Brennan does a good job of escaping the pocket. Not sure if that was designed or not. He got out of the pocket quickly, but good pickup on second down.
Brennan trying to go deep over the middle. It's caught for an LSU first down right on top of the logo.
And there's the play action, Dre Jenkins. This is the same play they had dialed up the second drive against Mississippi State, and Brennan didn't pull the trigger on a play that would have been a touchdown. This time, there's coverage there, but a confident, aggressive throw by Miles Brennan right on the money.
Brennan 7 of 9 tonight. They'll keep it on the ground. Here's Price again. Cole, it sounds really loud there. I know there's hardly anybody in the stadium. Why is it so loud?
Well, crowd noise is being pumped in, and it does feel a lot louder when LSU has the football, but there have been a few times that I've kind of looked left and looked right, and I've seen verbally this LSU offense have trouble communicating.
We got a flag on the play. How do we feel about that, Jordan? I mean, should we? That's, by
All
the
start.
Way.
Offense number 61. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Something that has been over the years illegal in the NFL, obviously. Falcons got fined for it a few years ago. So should home teams be allowed just to pump up the noise as loud as they want to go when the other team's got the ball?
I mean, as long as there's a standard across the board, but then that still kind of creates an unfair advantage because Vandy's, even when it's packed, it's probably not as loud as not even close to what a Death Valley would be. So I don't know how I feel about it.
Remember when we were there last year, the LSU fans drank them out of beer in the first half. Had to roll another Bud Light truck onto the concourse.
That's right.
Here's Price, and Price is met at the line of scrimmage. No gain. Vandy's defense had a solid game last week against A&M. They took three fumbles away. And Anthony Orgie, pardon me, Alston Orgie, his brother, comes in on a stop there.
Third and eight. We haven't called Terrace Marshall's number yet. Not sure if he's down here at the bottom or not. So I don't think he's on the field. Empty protection. Vandy doesn't look like they're bringing an extra defender, so Brennan will have some time to get this ball off.
You got, speaking of numbers, number two, Eric Gilbert, the tight end attached on the left side of the line. Brennan looking right all the way. Dropped. Would have been a first down for Dre Jenkins. Had a career high 85 yards last week against the Bulldogs.
It's a great play design. It's just an out from the slot. Great job setting up the break at the top and then just doesn't concentrate, thinking about what he's going to do when his feet hit the ground before he secures the ball for a first down.
To bring Von Rosenberg back out. Yep.
That's just some of the inexperience we're going to see this season. A true sophomore, he's extremely talented. but you don't have the same characters like Justin Jefferson and Jamar Chase out there. Gonna be some ups and downs.
Von Rosenberg gets rid of it. Cam Johnson lets it go. No, he comes up to get it. Like that. 34-yard punt. Here's what we got on the menu tonight, boys. SEC Saturday night, how not to stop the air raid. We'll tell you the story about a Nigerian prince and a separate story about an Academy Award winner. We'll also talk delayed weddings. Jordan knows something about that. Ruffino's great MLB impact. Saw that for the Padres last night. And what does a photo from Back to the Future have in common with this LSU team?
That's heavy.
Can you figure any of those out yet?
This little menu, I'm excited. I don't know what half that stuff is.
Somebody got a pair of Air Mags?
Oh, those are legit. I'm surprised you don't, Cole, with your shoe game, the blue skimmies on the sideline.
That's expensive.
Jamari Wakefield on first down finds three. Jabril Cox, a senior from Kansas City, by way of North Dakota State, in on the stop. How about the story of Cox? This guy coming from North Dakota State with an opportunity to play. He wasted no time being an impactful player last week. LSU, what a slow start offensively. It's a 7-0 lead for the Tigers through one. We'll take you back to Nashville right after this.
Imagine a future where machine learning will track your sleep.
Excuse me, ma'am?
Yes?
Yeah, this already does that.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Well, now you do.
Let's try this again. Imagine one day you'll be able to take an ECG.
It already does that.
Really? What about detect hard falls? Does it do that?
Does that.
Does that. Does that.
Thank you. Encouraging you to stay fit.
Does that.
Oh, I don't know. Imagine a tiny device that will check your blood oxygen level.
It already does that.
Well, that was fun.
Circling the block, two times, you know how we rock. You know who we knocked on, you know who we shot. You know how we coming, come for nothing I got. Just wanna have fun.
Jabril Cox played his high school ball at Raytown South in Kansas City. Then went on to North Dakota State, where he was a two-time FCS All-American, part of three national championship teams with the Bison. And now he's making the transition to the SEC. Interesting story.
And pretty amazing that after the game last week, I think they asked him, you know, was the speed any different? He said, no. I don't know if I believe him. The FCS is a little, not quite as fast as the SEC, but it just shows you that no moment is too big for this guy. He's a big-time player at any level, obviously.
Seals taken down in the backfield. Bo Pelini's defense coming up with a sack. It's his first year back in Baton Rouge, formerly the defensive coordinator there before moving on to Nebraska. And then Youngstown State as the head coach.
Cox actually had the pressure there. You know, it's interesting, this defense, it was a 3-4 under Dave Aranda, now transitioning back to a 4-3 under Bo Pelini. I was kind of asking him, what does that mean? Where on the field are guys not quite where they need to be? Says we're light at linebacker, had a lot of big nose guards that now are having to play three technique. So it's a work in progress. The bodies aren't quite there to fit it perfectly, but still generating pressure. Two back-to-back plays, they're getting pressure on Ken Seals, and actually Andre Anthony there working on the inside. He's a rush in, they'll move him inside at times. So good with his hands, great extension, getting after Seals and getting his hands up at the end. Ollie Gay worked in there as well, the JUCO transfer. It was a breakout star last week against Mississippi State with 11 pressures. They're talented up there, and they're just figuring out how to fit these pieces perfectly into this Pelini scheme.
Fourth punt of the night for Vandy. Stingley makes the first man miss. Bounces to the outside, takes it to midfield, and Derek Stingley down the sideline. He's an impact player on the defensive side and now on special teams.
He's just a special athlete. I mean, doesn't need a ball in his hands. But when he does have the ball in his hands, he is absolutely dynamic. You'd love to see him get on the offensive side of the ball. You know, when I was at Vandy, we had Casey Hayward, who's still playing in the NFL, one of the best defenders. And he was like a Derek Stingley, just incredible instincts. And we get him on the offensive side of the ball every now and then just to give it to him in space. He was that talented. You'd love to see Stingley on the offensive side every now and then.
Oh, I love that idea. Here's John Emery, straight ahead, running right through that jersey again, and he gets tripped up at the 22-yard line, a gain of 17.
I mean, I love watching John Emery right now. Just watch how quickly he gets vertical. 1 foot in the ground, gets vertical, gets skinny. That's the second time there's not really a hole there, but he was able to get skinny, navigate through it, and then burst on the other side for a big gain.
Kind of looked like a crunch play right there. Double inside zone, sort of, so to speak.
Good pressure by Vandy, but he runs right by it. Tripped up. And another big gain. This one will go for almost seven. First career start against Mississippi State. He had a career game against Vandy last year with 9 carries and 51 yards. John Emery Jr. gets taken down for a loss. Vandy with great penetration. It's a loss of 3.
You know, red zone is an emphasis with LSU, and they brought on Scott Linehan to replace Joe Brady. And really, Coach O said his specialty, his biggest help, has been third down in the red zone. Right now, you got to find number 6, Terrace Marshall, in the slot, in the middle, at the top of your screen. Find number 6. I think they're getting a good opportunity. Got press on the outside, and the man about 8 yards off of Terrace Marshall. That's where I'd go with the football. You see Gilbert here in the slot. This is a high-low combination. They get that underneath defender to bite up, and he got one-on-one with Terrace Marshall and great leverage, and that ball's just got to beat that safety there, and actually Frank Coppett could have made a better play on that ball. But again, Terrace Marshall is a big-bodied receiver at 6'3". If I'm Miles Brennan, I would do just that. Trust him to make a play in tight coverage and use his frame to block out defenders.
You have to wonder the impact of no Jalen Mahoney in that Vanderbilt secondary. Undisclosed injury. Will not play tonight for the Commodores. Pretty big loss.
Yeah, and he's the nickelback, so he might have been over the top of him or Gilbert on that play. So absolutely, but again, I don't care who it is. Terrace Marshall has proven it. Didn't matter last year. 13 touchdowns, like I said, 3 this year. I mean, he's the go-to guy for Miles Brennan. I was interested to see, with no Justin Jefferson, no Ja'Marr Chase, all the attention on Marshall, how would he fare? And he hasn't missed a beat.
Donovan Kaufman will not bring it out. Never guess who I ran into last night in Charlotte. Chizik and Doring. They'll be back at it tonight. Those guys worked so hard. A show last night with Dari. Another show tonight with Roman, who's, by the way, the hardest working guy at the network. He goes from sunrise to past sundown.
It's a long
SEC
day for
college
those guys.
Football final. Yeah, I know. They complained about it last night. Talk to Chizik actually about what LSU didn't do defensively last week against the air raid. And he said, when I was at Texas and we faced the air raid, when Mike Leach was at Texas Tech, I just loved to keep things simple. I didn't ask my guys to do too much. I didn't ask for excess communication. Just keep it simple. But he lulls you, Leach will lull you into a sense that he's simple too, and that you can get overly creative. And that is walking into a trap.
And it was a trap week one. I mean, if LSU plays Mississippi State week 6, week 5, and they have some tape, I think it's a different story. But Bo Pelini also has that mantra. You know, I asked him, describe your defense. He said, we're multiple, but we're simple. We can change personnel. We can make it look different. But to us, a lot of it is the same, which allows players to go fast.
I hear that, and both Ed Ogeron and Bo Pelini said that when we talked to him this week about, boy, if we had film. Well, it's the air raid, right? I mean, it's not like nobody's seen it before. How Mummy ran it at Kentucky years ago. We saw it in the XFL this spring. Is it simple or is it complicated?
oh, it's complicated to defense. It's simple to the offense. But I tell you what, I think they were focused on how Kylan Hill was going to be used in there. I think there was a little unknown of would it be all Mike Leach's air raid? Would it be a little bit of what they did last year sprinkled with air raid?
Ben Bresnahan up the sideline. Great job to stay in bounds. Bill Pelini not happy on the sideline after that gain of 18. There's a lot of completions and catch and runs up the sideline last week.
Yeah, I think that was what Coach O was most disappointed with, the effort, the loafs. He graded every loaf. He talked to the guys about their effort. That was the focus. They ran on Monday for how many loafs they had, which is, you know, your backside of a play. You're not tracking the ball.
First down. The previous play is under review.
They're going to review this play to see where he stepped out of bounds. They don't want to review that Mississippi State game film. 383 yards after the catch from Mississippi State receivers, including Kylan Hill, who you mentioned. Where was it?
Ooh. He did a good job of staying in there.
6'4", 244.
And this is really when Vandy's at their best. 12 personnel, which means one running back, two tight ends. Everything should center off of the zone, outside zone. Play action off it, get it rolling, and that's when your quarterback's at its best, and that's when your offense can control the clock and move the football effectively. Just been a little hit or miss right now early in this game for Vandy.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. First down.
It's a fresh set of downs for Vandy. Elsewhere in SEC action, Georgia leads Auburn 10-7. That game's on ESPN, and Georgia threatening to score again. They have been living in Auburn territory here as they're early in the second quarter in Athens. Mississippi State and Arkansas tied early on. Seals steps forward, drops back, and he'll dump it out of the backfield. Trying to find Jaden Harrison.
I tell you what, a good-looking true freshman, number 99, Jaquellen Roy, 6'4", 300 pounds for LSU. These are the plays that don't go in the stat sheet, but he drove the guard and center back into the quarterback, which condensed the pocket and caused Ken Seals to panic there. So this defensive front is going to be good. This defense is going to be good, and they're going to continue to get better week to week.
Seals trying to escape that push, and he lowers his shoulder and took a hit at the line of scrimmage to pick up two. Jabril Cox came up and made contact with him.
Watch Roy again, a true freshman. Watch this. 99 working on the right guard. Look at him just drive one arm, drive him all the way back again. Nothing on the stat sheet there, but that is why Ken Seals had to escape the pocket. Those are plays that disrupt an offensive rhythm. And Drew Birchmeyer's going, man, I don't know about this offensive line thing. I used to do that to guys on D-line.
Vandy just 1 of 5 on third down. And that's a gain of 4 when they needed 8. Amir Abdulrahman with his first catch of the night. Two touchdown lead for LSU here in the second.
I was going to say, that play just dialed up to get half, right? Go for it on fourth, kind of in that no man's land. Not going to kick a field goal. You're not going to punt it. So pick us up some yards. Get us in a fourth down that's manageable.
They converted a fourth down last week in their loss at College Station against A&M. Seals over the middle. Incomplete. Fantastic coverage on Abdulrahman by Eli Ricks, the freshman. This already looks better than last week, Jordan.
Yeah, these crossers are not going to work this week. We watched film. We learned. LSU defense looking confident.
Imagine a future where machine learning will track your sleep.
Excuse me, ma'am?
Yes?
Yeah, this already does that.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Well, now you do.
Let's try this again.
Imagine one day you'll be able to take an ECG.
It already does that.
Really? What about detect hard falls? Does it do that?
Does that.
Does that. Does that.
Thank you. Encouraging you to stay fit.
Does that.
Oh, I don't know. Imagine a tiny device that will check your blood oxygen level.
It already does that.
Well,
That was fun.
We live in uncertain times. However, there is one thing you can be certain of.
Morning, everybody.
The men and women of the United States Postal Service. We are here to deliver your cards, packages, and prescriptions. And also deliver the peace of mind knowing that what's important to you, like your ballot, is on its way. Every day, all across America, we deliver for you. And we always will.
Thought being the last man standing on Bourbon Street has been a badge of honor, but it doesn't feel good the next day. And that's kind of what happened when Dave Aranda first left for Baylor, took the head coaching job there. And after a championship season, LSU lost 14 starters to the NFL, including the Heisman Trophy winner. That was Goodell driving that float. You lost some guys at graduation, and who's left after that, off of that championship team? And the biggest question we had for Ed Orgeron was, how do you reintroduce the culture to this group? He said, man, it's a learning process. 3 years ago, we lost to Troy. It was a low point, but we toughened up from it. We became a championship team because of the adversity. Well, they got some right off the bat in week one against Mississippi State.
I think so much of that leadership and that perennial chip on the shoulder and the confidence that LSU had last year stemmed from Joe Burrow. I mean, I feel like they took his personality, and I think this offense is searching for that leader. They have a few on defense. I think this offense is still searching for that fire, though, that leadership when they hit adversity.
When's the last time you're on Bourbon Street?
2 years? I wouldn't remember that.
Probably came home with dirty shoes. On second and 10, pressure on Brennan. He eludes a rush and dumps it off on a crossing route incomplete, trying to find Terrace Marshall. Pardon me.
I think I came home barefoot.
Not Marshall, they're
so
working with somebody.
A good night.
As one does. That was Coy Moore. They're trying to get involved in the offense. And it leaves third and 10.
Watch Gilbert here in the slot.
Brennan has time over the middle. Intercepted. Overthrew his man, and Vandy's got another takeaway. This one belongs to Randall Haney. After three fumble recoveries against A&M last week, they have their first takeaway tonight.
Well, they had a seam up the middle by Gilbert and a dig right behind it. Brennan wanted to fit this into Gilbert. Watch this. Safety Kaufman goes there over the top, tries to squeeze in the dig, and it's just behind. Just behind. This is what happens to a quarterback in a pocket. When you come off one read quickly to the next, sometimes you're spot throwing. You're not leading the guy. You're not looking at space ahead of him. You're trying to throw it to him. And if you do that at quarterback, it's going to end up behind him, as we saw there.
Couple of picks last week for Brennan against Mississippi State. Good field position for Vandy. Here's Jamari Wakefield.
You know, though, that's one of the first mistakes, because the two picks last week, one he got his arm hit, the other was a Hail Mary, so I don't really chalk those up to him. There was one time that similar play, he tried to fit in a dig route, he got hit, the ball ended up going down. I think if he would have thrown it, it would have been intercepted. So that's just something, throwing over the middle is not something you pick up right away. Obviously, Joe Burrow didn't do it. He excelled at it in 19, but 18, they didn't do a ton of it. It's just tougher to see. It's tougher to anticipate and lead your receivers comfortably.
Seals over the middle. Vanderbilt first down for Cam Johnson inside the 20. Pick up a 40.
And Kent Seals is like, hey, I'm a true freshman. Watch this. I mean, he attacks the middle of the field. Look at his eyes. Love it. Pump fake. Moves the defense, opens up the vacancy in the middle. Great little adjustment by Cam Johnson there for a big game.
Todd Fitch, the new offensive coordinator for Vanderbilt. How will they look different under Fitch's direction this season?
Well, you know, that's what we've kind of been looking for. I think they use tempo a little bit more than they did under Andy Ludwig. Under Ludwig, you saw a lot of shifts in trades, a lot of double tight end moving from one side to the other. You don't see as much of that with Fitch. But again, I think this identity is still growing on what Ken Seals can do. How good their offensive line can be was a huge question coming into the season. They'll continue to evolve.
On the play action rollout, they go back to the tight end, Ben Bresnahan. He picks up four.
But right now, it's play action off outside zone. That's the money combination for them right now.
On third and short, Seals gives it to Wakefield, and he pushes for a first down for Vandy. Wakefield on carry. Seals going to split out wide. And a quarterback keeper off the zone read to the pylon. And they will mark him short. Outside at the 1.5, it's Mike Wright. And a gain of six.
Another true freshman. It was amazing how much Coach Mason and Todd Fitch, the offensive coordinator, talked up the talent of their two true freshman quarterbacks. Mike Wright, a different skill set. He's an athlete. Love that they brought him in here. Ran a little outside zone, zone read, and almost punched it in there for his first play.
And there for a second play on second and goal.
Ruling on the field, player stepped out of bounds prior to breaking the goal line plane. The previous play is under review.
So this will be a question about his feet and whether they're outside the one, because he did get the pylon. Watch his right foot. And they'll need to know if the ball was across the goal line before the foot came down.
That's not going to be the angle. This one might be a little better. It's going to be hard to tell. Watch that right foot down. I don't think there's enough there on that replay to tell me that the ball was definitively across the line when that right foot hits out of bounds.
Regardless, the spot should improve, because
yes. It
looked like the ball was just outside the end line when his foot came down. It's where the ball is when his foot touches out of bounds, not where his foot touched.
Here's where
After
we need that
review,
pylon
the ruling of the player stepping out of bounds is confirmed.
Among other things.
Yeah.
So they confirmed the ruling that he stepped out of bounds, which we knew, but the question is, are they going to change the spot?
I mean,
we didn't need a confirmation that he was out of bounds. Yeah.
Yeah, it should be about the half-yard line, right? At worst. That was very close to being a touchdown, so let's see if they move the spot or not.
Wow, they like the spot. That's
LSU
wrong.
Likes the spot.
No doubt. Little toss, it'll go as a pass and nothing doing. Okay, Jordan, walk me through this. That's a yard difference from where the ball was spotted, maybe more than where we thought it should have been. Does that drastically affect your play calling that close to the goal line?
Absolutely. I mean, a yard and a half, you're not going to quarterback sneak. And I love the quarterback sneak inside the one, anywhere on that 6-inch yard line inside the one. I don't mind the little trick gadget play right there, but man, Ollie Gay has been playing out of his mind. LSU has found a guy on the edge that is super talented. He had 11 pressures last week, one sack, batted some balls, and a great job there of staying home and stopping a touchdown.
So now it's third and goal, nearly to the 10. Seals end zone shot. Caught. Touchdown, Vanderbilt.
Touchdown.
Back to the tight end, Bresnahan, and an 8-yard strike.
Look at Ken Seals, true freshman. I think Fitz, the offensive coordinator, has done a great job of mixing up the play calling for him. Get him outside the pocket. Get him comfortable. Then here in the red zone, all the windows are smaller. You got a true freshman quarterback playing from the pocket, drives one in there to his tight end in tight coverage. That's a heck of a play when Vandy needed it.
Pearson Cook for the point after, and it will sneak across the bar. An 8-play, 58-yard drive. It took 3:57 off the clock. It started with a Vanderbilt interception and gave them their best field position. Haney with the pick off the overthrow, and then Seals finds Bresnahan. Vanderbilt's on the board here in the first half.
Imagine a future where machine learning will track your sleep.
Excuse me, ma'am?
Yes?
Yeah, this already does that.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Well, now you do.
Let's try this again.
Imagine one day you'll be able to take an ECG.
It already does that.
Really? What about detect hard falls? Does it do that?
Does that.
Does that. Does that.
Thank you. Encourage you to stay fit.
Does that.
Oh, I don't know. Imagine a tiny device that will check your blood oxygen level.
It already does that. Well, that was fun.
American Family Insurance is returning $425 million to our customers. This includes a 10% savings for all current and new auto customers for the rest of the year. We hope this does your world some good. Contact your agent or go to amfam.com to learn about more ways to save.
Pearson Cook will kick it away for Vandy. Touchdown deficit for the Commodores. Tyron Davis Price back to receive for LSU. And he'll let it go over his head.
Kickoff goes out of the end zone for a touchback.
This season, for every field goal and extra point made by participating universities, Allstate will make a contribution to the university's General Scholarship Fund. Thank you, Allstate. Hey, shout out to Larry Leathers, so good as a sports information director for years and years. In fact, he was there so long, he was there when Jordan played, and a great Vanderbilt career.
Larry's my guy. He was great for the program. Sad to see him go, but happy he's having a beer on the couch watching the game.
Down the sideline, and John Emery Jr. picks up 8. What do you guys like about Vanderbilt's defense this year?
Well, look, I think they're doing a great job of the whole bend but don't break, keep things in front of you, and then they're opportunistic. Every Vanderbilt defense that's been successful in the last decade or more has been opportunistic. They take the ball away. They're ball hungry. That's the biggest focus for Ted Roof in this defense.
Here's a gash by Emery, and Emery takes it just shy of midfield goal.
The two things that I've noticed, first and foremost, are the tackling has absolutely improved, and the defensive line play has been better, more active, more disruptive. I know it was only one film against Texas A&M and a little bit tonight, but those are two things that stick out to me early.
Dio Dango, number 10, their star on the D-line. Brennan has time over the middle. Caught, first down LSU. Here goes Terrace Marshall. It's his second of the night. It covers 51 yards, and LSU with a quick answer.
You know what I love? I love that Ensminger just dials up another dig right after Brennan threw an interception. Just like last week when he misses a deep shot, he dials it back up. He says, it's okay, I have confidence in you. You can make this throw, and bam, right on the money. What is that, two catches, two touchdowns?
That's efficient.
That's not bad. They had a decent day at the office.
Cade York. Inside the upright. 3 plays, 75-yard drive. LSU's wide receivers were some of the best in the country last year. Terrace Marshall says, hey, don't forget about me. I'm still here. And the junior from Bossier City takes it 51 yards for the Tigers.
Imagine a future where machine learning will track your sleep.
Excuse me, ma'am?
Yes?
Yeah. This already does that.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Well, now you do.
Let's try this again. Imagine one day you'll be able to take an ECG.
It already does that.
Really? What about detect hard falls? Does it do that?
Does that.
Thank you. Encourage you to stay fit.
Does that.
Oh, I don't know. Imagine a tiny device that will check your blood oxygen level.
It already does that. Well, that was fun.
We live in uncertain times. However, there is one thing you can be certain of. The men and women of the United States Postal Service. We are here to deliver your cards, packages, and prescriptions. And also deliver the peace of mind knowing that what's important to you, like your ballot, is on its way. Every day, all across America, we deliver for you. And we always will.
268 yards of offense for LSU with a 21-7 lead. Brennan, 10 of 16 for a 175 already. Terrace Marshall, 2 catches, 2 touchdowns.
I love that right there. Walking down, up and down the sidelines, talking to guys. It's a little outside of his comfort zone. I think that's, Joe Burrow did such a good job last year of being fiery, of getting guys motivated. Sometimes as a quarterback, even if it's outside your comfort zone, you've got to learn how to do it.
Coffin's going to bring it out. And the New Orleans native has it past the 25. He's already at the 50 and into LSU territory. Ball came loose at the end, but a 58-yard kickoff return.
Tell you what, breaking down the film of Texas A&M last week, Donovan Coffman, the true freshman safety, flashed on defense. He was everywhere. And this is why, the speed, the explosiveness.
Four-star of Archbishop
Rumble. Get these guys on the offensive side of the ball, Tom. I'm a quarterback. I want Stingley on my side. I want this guy on my side.
Here's Jamie Marlowe. Cameron Lewis, a senior from Monroe, with the stop, a gain of 11.
That's your mic man going full hacksaw Jim Duggan there, Tom.
I love it. Does he have a 2x4 over his shoulder?
He did earlier. I think he lost it.
LSU uses a timeout. Our studio's been so busy today, haven't had a chance to grab any dinner, but they know the Georgia Dogs are eating. Dari, what do you got? Well, Chiz and Doring took me to a place that didn't have any food last night, so I'm not so sure they're worried about it. Georgia up 24-0. I'm sure the guys at the half will talk about where Georgia's offense came from. I didn't know Stetson Bennett was capable of that, Jordan.
I honestly didn't either. I mean, you saw good things out of him as far as managing the game, but I didn't know if they could be dynamic with him at the quarterback position. But hey, I was way wrong, obviously.
Yeah. Here's Marlowe.
Don't pull up my picks either from Nation this morning.
No? Bad look?
Yeah, let's don't forget about that. Hey, Georgia, my bad. My bad.
Bo Nix is only 5 for 10 in the first half. Second and 4 now for Vandy. Seals on the rollout. Slides into second with a pickup of 2.
You know what we haven't seen yet is Ken Seals throw at Derek Stingley. And I asked him about it. I said, do you pay a little extra attention? He said, well, if all's even, I'm going to go in the other direction. But then he kind of had a little bit of a smile and said, but man, I'd like to get one over the top on him. I just say, hey, be careful. You got to be really careful throwing in the direction of Derek Stingley.
What did you think when he said that? Did that sound like a Texas gunslinger, or did it sound like a freshman? Because to me, there's two very different perspectives.
I think it sounded like a gunslinger. It wasn't naive in the way he was saying it. It was, I know he's good, but the competitor in me wants to get one on him.
Vanderbilt can make this thing really interesting before the end of the half. Both teams have converted in the red zone. And a solid run by Wakefield.
Hey, Jordan, I want to go back to the Derek Stingley situation. We've seen shutdown corners at every level of football for a long time. As a quarterback, when do you make that identification, and how often do you make that identification across the course of a game?
Every single play.
As soon as you break the huddle?
As I break the huddle, back when we used to huddle, out of the corner of my eye, I don't want to make it obvious that I'm looking for him, but I find him on the field, and then I recalculate where my read should go.
Here's Jamari Wakefield again.
I mean, I ran the practice squad every day at Tampa Bay against Darrell Revis. And let me tell you, I just knew where he was at all times. And every time I had to throw in his direction, I was a little tight, you know. I was worried as the ball was releasing. I didn't get the velocity or accuracy I wanted because I was thinking about placing it, about keeping it away from him. And that's the struggle with a good corner. It's not that you want to stay away from him. Yes, you do. But even when you throw at him, you're so cognizant of it that you don't get the same velocity, the same spin, the same accuracy, unless you're just not worried about it at all. But when it's 24 out there.
Yeah, there's another way to avoid him. That's just keep it on the ground. This will be the eighth play of this drive, all seven runs.
And that's the recipe for Vandy. Getting 12 personnel, two tight ends, and run the football.
They run it again. Wakefield bounces it to the near side. And it's a pickup of one out of bounds with 48 seconds left on the clock.
I think if you're
second and goal,
three is not going to do it. You want to get seven here. We just saw Miles Brennan and LSU score very quickly. I think you're calculating that this game, as an offense, you need to keep pace. So I expect a couple shots into the end zone here.
Mike Wright in the game with Rocco Griffin, couple of freshmen in the backfield. Wright takes a snap. Another QB run for him. He's at the five, and he got licked, turned upside down by Jacoby Stevens. It's a gain of four. It'll leave third and goal.
Man, I really thought this was the play action, right? You got Mike Wright in. LSU knows you want to run the football. And he gets a good initial push, but look at Jacoby Stevens. I mean, this is a complete player. This safety, he can play at all three levels. And look at the form tackle, the explosiveness, the speed. We got a chance to talk to him yesterday, and I thought it was interesting. I said, you know, what did you do after watching that tape? And he said, you know what? I put the whole defense on punishment. I said, wait, what does that mean? He goes, well, usually during the week, you know, we'll watch Monday night football together. We'll play some video games, watch Thursday night football. I said, nope. I said, we're only watching Vanderbilt. Nothing but football. And I was like, did you have to go knock on dorm rooms? He's like, no, but I had to text a few people to remind them that this is football only, Vanderbilt only week. And I tell you what, they're focused.
Jordan, he was the guy that nobody talked about on that defense a year ago. And there was a lot of star power. He showed up all over the place. Favorite thing that I saw from him in the Mississippi State game last week, he was the lead man on a couple of stunts when they were attempting to bring pressure, which essentially means it's his job to take out one offensive lineman so they can't trade a twist or blitz off to get to the loop man. And it's not a, hey, I might try to squeeze through here. You attack that guy and try to knock him off his feet, and Jacoby Stevens had no issue doing it multiple times.
He's got no fear.
Here's a key third and goal. Vandy has converted their last four third downs. 25 seconds remaining on the first half clock. Vandy has one timeout left. Seals looking end zone, lobs. It is incomplete. And that's going to leave fourth and goal. Chris Pierce, the intended receiver. Stingley had the coverage. He went after number 24.
And there it was. They win at Stingley, and this is the matchup you want if you're going to go at number 24. It's Chris Pierce, the senior. He's savvy. He's also 6'4", your biggest body. I like the placement by Seals, but just too physical from Stingley on the outside. Pierce couldn't get up and make that play.
Vandy will try to take the three, 22-yard attempt for Pearson Cook. And the 22-yarder's no good. He missed it left.
Wow, how demoralizing. You drive all the way down, have an opportunity to score before half. You settle for a field goal and then just a complete miss. Did he get the laces there? He might have got the laces there. Not saying it should make a difference from this short, but mentally, you know, kickers, they're fragile. Let's see.
He did get the laces.
Stop. Look, it shouldn't matter. It should not. I've talked to so many kickers. It shouldn't matter from this distance, but it's a mental thing. When you see that, your mechanics just change and you yank it.
So LSU catches a break with Vandy unable to convert the short field goal. The chip shot misses by a football, and Vanderbilt gets nothing out of it. 260 yards of offense for LSU to 203 for Vandy. And it's a two-touchdown lead at the half. LSU will receive the second half kickoff. A lot to catch you up to date on. Here's Dari in the game.
A little taller. I can't hear
it. It's not his fault he's not by the speaker. They put it away from the microphone.
I'm not joking.
I can't. Coach O, can you hear me?
Okay.
You got me? Nothing? Nothing. Can you hear me, Coach? No? No, I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to Orgeron.
Missed field goal at the end of the half cost Vandy some points. It's a 21-7 lead for number 20 LSU as we start the third quarter. Let's take a look at our first half stats brought to you by Zaxby's.
I mean, this is the equation that Vanderbilt wanted. They wanted to control the clock. They've rushed for over 100 yards, but it's been the explosive plays from LSU, specifically Brennan to Terrace Marshall, that have really been the difference in this game.
Let's get down the field and check in with Cole.
Hey guys, I spoke to LSU head coach Ed Orgeron going into the locker room, and he said loves the way his defensive line is performing in this game tonight. Also said he's seen the confidence of Miles Brennan grow throughout this game. Said he was a big fan of Steve Insminger going right back to that play that Jordan mentioned earlier in the broadcast and hitting Terrence Marshall for a touchdown pass. Spoke to Derek Mason as well. He said that's a have to forget defensively and offensively. Yes, the run game's been successful, but he believes they can pass on LSU in the second half.
Interesting. We'll see what kind of adjustments LSU is able to make. Pearson Cook puts it in the air. No return for LSU. Returning wide receiver, Terrace Marshall, making an impact in this one.
I mean, he was third wheel last year on the outside behind Justin Jefferson and Ja'Marr Chase, and he has all the spotlight this year, and for good reason. He is 6'3", 200 pounds. He's physically imposing, but watch the speed here as he runs by the Vanderbilt defense. He's a special player, and Brennan and him are clicking right now.
Brennan, 10 of 16 in the first half, three touchdowns and a pick on an overthrow. Here's John Emery Jr. And he finds 6 yards on first down.
You know, I think they'll be pleased with John Emery. We spoke to Coach O, and he mentioned that we need to be more diverse in the run game. He's like, last year we had one play, inside zone, but we had Clyde. This year we don't. But hey, you know what? They haven't done much different. It's been a lot of inside zone, but John Emery has excelled. He's hitting the hole hard. He's averaging over 11 a carry right now.
It wasn't just Clyde Edwards-Helaire that they lost to the NFL. Boy, they lost a ton of talent. And Chiefs fans are learning firsthand just how good Helaire is. There's a lot of guys making noise at the next level already. I mean, look at this talent that moved on. And Justin Jefferson's coming off of a big one, huh?
175 yards the other day. I mentioned Patrick Queen. That's a huge loss. Kalavon Chase on. And, oh, by the way, Joe Burrow, he's picked up right where he left off. But, man, he's on a bad team right now. They got to protect him. That's rough to watch.
On third and one, they go QB sneak. And we'll see if Brennan got it or not. You're going to be inches short.
Given the forward progress, they didn't.
Interesting you mentioned those guys gone. Lloyd Cushenberry starting for the Broncos. Damian Lewis, right guard, starting for the Seahawks. They come in handy in situations like this as well, no longer a part of this LSU team.
So Zach Von Rosenberg will come on as LSU fails to pick up the third and short on the QB sneak. Cam Johnson is back. Fair catch by Johnson. Interesting chat with Kent Seals this week, and words coming from the Vandy quarterback. It's a program, Jordan, that you obviously know well, having played there and trying to get over the hump. And wherever that hump is, Seals referenced it. This isn't the same Vanderbilt that people have played in the past. Said that after the loss to number 10 A&M. So you've been in his shoes. How can you make sure that it's not the same Vanderbilt? How can you get a program over the hump?
Well, it's got to be a mindset. I remember when I first got to Vandy in 2010, we didn't believe in ourselves. We didn't think we could compete. We didn't think we could win tight football games, and we didn't because of that. And I think that's what Ken Seals is referencing. They were in a tight game at Texas A&M, and they believed that they could win that football game. At Vandy, you're going to be in an uphill battle. You're not going to have the same talent that other SEC schools are going to have that you face week in and week out. So you have to out-hustle. You have to out-effort the opponent, and you have to believe. And they're starting to believe around this true freshman quarterback.
They were really behind the eight ball when it came to COVID-19 in fall camp. They had a pause of 5 days after getting back in June, and there was some apprehension amongst the players. They wanted to get their tests back before they returned to the field, but it also impacted the quarterback race. As Seals competing with a couple other guys, and two of the four that were competing for the starting spot had to go into quarantine. That left the younger guys to get all the reps, and boy, was that a huge benefit. You get reps, you get better every day. And Derek Mason said after that, Ken Seals deserved the opportunity to start. On third and six, got Stevens caught up on a blitz, and it's off the hands of Marlowe. Missed opportunity for Vandy. Marlowe would still be running.
And those are the plays that you got to come down with. Jacoby Stevens comes up to the ball really quickly right before the snap, and he actually runs himself into a natural pick play. Watch this. Comes up. He's going to guard the running back. Gets picked because he gets down too low on the same level as the cornerback. And that is a play you got to have if you're Javion Marlowe. Big missed opportunity there.
Harrison Smith earning his scholarship tonight. Trey Palmer, the new returner for LSU from the 31. Palmer cuts it upfield. And a 10-yard return. LSU will be back on offense. 53-yard punt, 10 on the return. Miles Brennan back to work for the Tigers.
You could take your ulcerative colitis treatment in a different direction. Talk to your doctor about Xeljanz, a pill, not an injection or infusion, for adults with moderate to severe ulcerative colitis when a certain medicine did not help enough. Xeljanz is the first and only FDA-approved pill for moderate to severe UC. It can reduce symptoms in as early as 2 weeks, improve the appearance of the intestinal lining, and provide lasting steroid-free remission. Xeljanz can lower your ability to fight infections. Before and during treatment, your doctor should check for infections like TB and do blood tests. Tell your doctor if you've had hepatitis B or C, have flu-like symptoms, or are prone to infections. Serious, sometimes fatal infections, cancers, including lymphoma, and blood clots have happened. Taking a higher than recommended dose of Xeljanz for RA may increase risk of death. Tears in the stomach or intestines and serious allergic reactions have happened. You could take your UC treatment in a different direction. Ask your gastroenterologist about Xeljanz.
The Big Ten, Mountain West, MAC, and Pac-12 have announced their plans to return to play. Now all FBS conferences will play football this fall.
Pac-12 announced their schedule this morning. Really interesting as you look at the playoff calendar. First rankings released the 24th, selection show the 20th, semis on New Year's Day, and the championship on January 11th. Guys, did you see when the first Pac-12 game was going to kick off locally? 9 a.m. on the West Coast. Ooh. Wow. Come ready to play. John Emery out of the backfield. Brennan hits him, and then Emery gets hit.
I mean, you usually get to the stadium 2.5, 3 hours before a game. Are they going to get there at 6 a.m.?
That's about a 4 o'clock wake-up call for a game. The one reward for all the work that you put in, and you're going to be punished with a 4 or 4:30 a.m. wake-up call.
You tie it into Bourbon Street, maybe you just don't go to bed the night before. They go over the middle again. It's Dre Jenkins, and Jenkins has a gain of 10. Can't be any worse than doing Korean baseball at 5:35 in the morning. Brennan looking to go deep on a comeback route. It's complete to the edge, and LSU's got another first down through the air. And Brennan really sharing the football now. That's a gain of 12. Trey Palmer.
That's a great sign. I mean, we saw Kyle Trask week one complete the ball to so many different guys. I think he completed it to 8 different guys today. The best quarterbacks can make their reads and distribute the football and don't lock in on just one guy.
Eric Gilbert, the tight end, has only been targeted once tonight. He's blocking here. Had his guy, but John Emery Jr. got taken down by Demetri Moore, back playing for Vanderbilt after an up and down offseason in a kind of an odd storyline, but something we should get used to in COVID-19. He was a top tackler last season for Vanderbilt. Wasn't sure if he was going to play this year. Linebacker blitz and incomplete to Palmer. Demetri Moore and Derek Mason are really, really tight. He talked about Demetri having a tough offseason. He lost his grandpa who helped raise him, and he was just kind of unsure of what the future would look like from a football perspective. Brennan looking at a 3rd and 9 now. Four-man rush. They got to him with a hand in his face, and it falls incomplete.
It's a really good job on the edge there. Vanderbilt runs a little bit of a stunt. Davion Davis comes from the inside, number 9. You're going to see loop around. LSU struggles to pass it off at the end and just gets his hand. Ooh, that probably should have been a flag. He got his hand up in the face mask of Miles Brennan, but refs didn't see it.
53-yard attempt for Cade York. His career long is 52. Did that against Ole Miss. Donovan Kaufman in the back of the end zone if there's a return possibility. Leg is good, and it splits the upright from 53.
Laces out.
Cade York said, oh, you got somebody to return a missed field goal? How about I kick it 20 yards over his head? Kaufman watches it sail. It's like watching a home run ball.
You could take your ulcerative colitis treatment in a different direction. Talk to your doctor about Xeljanz, a pill, not an injection or infusion, for adults with moderate to severe ulcerative colitis when a certain medicine did not help enough. Xeljanz is the first and only FDA-approved pill for moderate to severe UC. It can reduce symptoms in as early as 2 weeks, improve the appearance of the intestinal lining, and provide lasting steroid-free remission. Xeljanz can lower your ability to fight infections. Before and during treatment, your doctor should check for infections like TB and do blood tests. Tell your doctor if you've had hepatitis B or C, have flu-like symptoms, or are prone to infections. Serious, sometimes fatal infections, cancers, including lymphoma, and blood clots have happened. Taking a higher than recommended dose of Xeljanz for RA may increase risk of death. Tears in the stomach or intestines and serious allergic reactions have happened. You could take your UC treatment in a different direction. Ask your gastroenterologist about Xeljanz.
A top 10 upset today. Texas fell to TCU at Austin. Gary Patterson has the Longhorns numbers, and Georgia putting a whipping on Auburn. They're getting ready to start the second half. It's 24-3 between the Hedges. Bulldogs in front.
Boy, and I'm going to eat some humble pie on that one. And everybody else on SEC Nation outside of Laura's daughter, Reese, picked Auburn. So we all got some explaining to do as Stetson Bennett absolutely owning Auburn right now.
Here's Donovan Kaufman. No return. Speaking of, let's take a look at the road to the championship brought to you by Mercedes-Benz. Well, if LSU wants to get back there, they're going to have to beat the odds. Entering the season, they had a 17% chance to win the West. That dropped to 1.5% after the loss to Mississippi State. Given what we know about the Pac-12 schedule, guys, and the Big Ten schedule, I mean, do you have to win the division in the SEC to make it into the college football playoff?
I think it depends. I will say in the West right now, it's looking a lot better for LSU. Auburn maybe isn't as good as we thought. Texas A&M, obviously, there was a lot of hype preseason. They're not as good. I mean, LSU has a chance if they continue to get better. And as far as the rest of the leagues go, I've been in those meetings of the mock college football playoff selection. You're really only looking at a handful, three, four games that you can look at similarly with ranked teams and top 10 teams. So it'll play into effect, but I don't think it'll be a deciding factor. It's going to be tough for the SEC to get two, I think.
Seals couldn't escape Jabril Cox. I don't know if it's really early, obviously, but Cole, the Big 12 has not performed to this point. I don't know if the Big 12 is going to have a spot.
No, one undefeated team left, and I just don't know if the rest of the league is going to be strong enough for you to get a team in. I mean, that's a concern for me with the Pac-12 as well. I look at down those schedules that were released this morning, and I'm thinking, well, who, even if they run the table here, are we going to be talking about as a college football playoff team?
Second and 13 now for Kent Seals and Vanderbilt, and Wakefield couldn't quite get out of the traffic. No gain. That will leave third and long. DJ Ojulari in on the stop. Freshman out of Marietta, Georgia. Brother linebacker at the University of Georgia. By the way, Arkansas has opened up a 21-7 lead against Mississippi State. Mike Leach's teams in their history, after huge wins, have a tendency to underperform. Seals will roll and flips it out of bounds. Did he get to the line of scrimmage? He was chased down by Jacoby Stevens, and Seals looks a little shaken up. They're going to mark where he was, and they're going to discuss this.
Well, again, getting Seals outside the pocket, but Andre Anthony coming from the inside. Look at the speed to close. And that's what Bo Pelini was talking about. He said at linebacker, because of the 3-4, we had a lot of rush ins, a lot of speed on the outside. We're transitioning some of these bodies, but right now I got to capitalize on what I have here, and speed is a big key for this team moving forward. Sideline to sideline like that, you'd love to see it.
Harrison Smith And we got stoppage. That was the third sack of the day for LSU.
False start. Offense number 12. 5-yard penalty. Remains fourth down.
Get the feeling Stingley could break one any moment. From the 31. Where's he going to go? He's going to go up the sideline, and he's got a burst. Derek Stingley set him up, and he's got the punter to beat, and he finally gets dragged down inside the 20. 50-yard punt, 49 on the return.
I mean, anytime you see a punt returner start to reverse field, stop and just kind of survey, look out. Because he's setting up some blocks and the vision of Derek Stingley to go down the sideline. So Hester-esque back in the day. And Tom, you called it.
Only thing making nicer being a Sam Willard suit. That was smooth. 8:13 to go in the third quarter. LSU knocking on the door. Vandy drops the safety back. They show pressure. Brennan goes after it, and it got tipped at the line of scrimmage. Jordan, what are you seeing from, forget about that pass being tipped, but Miles Brennan's vision when he's making decisions post-snap?
Well, I think it's improving. I think that was a struggle early on versus Mississippi State. One thing we haven't seen a ton of is the RPOs. We did see a run-pass option just there, something we saw a ton out of last year in Joe Brady's system. Not as much this year, but as this running game gets better, I expect that to increase. Right now, Brennan's comfort zone is quick game, getting the ball out fast, and obviously taking shots down the middle of the field. He's been effective tonight.
Play action, looking downfield again. Man coverage outside, incomplete. Wow, he gave it all. Jontre Kirkland laid out for it.
Oh, just about a foot too far. Brennan does a great job here of keeping his eyes down the center at first. He gets late to the outside, which is what you want to do to hold number 33, the safety there. And this is just, oh, so close.
They split Price out. Empty backfield for Brennan. And a check of the sideline. Looking for Eric Gilbert. And a big tight end has the catch and wants to rumble. Needed 10, got 7. That'll leave fourth and short. Brennan and the offense will head to the sideline. Yep.
Yeah. One thing we saw there on that third down, and you know, me and Cole were talking about, hadn't seen a ton of, is using the running back in motion pre-snap to create mismatches. We saw that so much out of Clyde Edwards-Helaire and Joe Brady using him, splitting him out wide, seeing if a linebacker goes out or if they bump across, and now a slot, often a slot receiver has a better matchup. Something they may evolve into. Again, game two, you're starting to see what you do best.
31-yard attempt from York. He's already made from 53. And he jams that one through the uprights. LSU is open a 20-point advantage here. Updates to come from Starkville and Athens in studio after this.
I'm excited. I'm excited. Junior garlic butter bacon burger.
I just want it right now.
Searching for meaning in a relentless world. Always connected, but somehow alone. Trapped by illusion. We offer another path, where the battle to belong begins. Awakened by a calling, united by the cause you fight for, no one can take away what it means to be among the few, the proud, the Marines.
All right, thanks, gang. In Nashville, 27-7. No return for Vandy. We showed you the menu to start the game, and one of the items was Nigerian Prince. Everybody's got a backstory. I don't know if I've seen a backstory like this one for B.J. Ojulari, freshman from Marietta High School. His older brother, Aziz Ojulari, plays at Georgia. He is the grandson of Nigerian Prince Twins 7-7. He set Marietta's single-season record with 19 sacks. Perhaps that's something you expect as the descendant of a war chief. Fantastic article in the Baton Rouge Advocate that displays all the details. Done by Brooks Cabana, but it's really incredible. His mom, Bolanli, grew up in a palace, and his late father, Oliani Asantoki, was a world-famous painter and a musician who toured the globe. Eventually changed his name to Prince Twin 7-7. It was a name that recognized he was the only surviving child of his parents' seven sets of twins. Jordan can't relate to this, but Cole, could you imagine the diaper bill?
Say that again. Seven sets of what?
Twins. Seven sets of twins. You got to be royalty to afford all the Pampers.
You're going to need some help.
Uh-huh.
I got my hands full babysitting Tom, so I can imagine the twins on a Saturday night.
I thought we were done talking about Bourbon Street. Third and five now for Kent Seals and Vanderbilt. Seals pressured. They got three sacks tonight. He gets rid of this one, and no intentional grounding past the line of scrimmage.
Pressure again on the outside by Ali Gay. He's been special. Him and Andre Anthony, and Jabril Cox. I mean, they're starting to develop the leadership, the consistency on defense. We knew some of the names. We didn't know who would emerge and continue to show up, play in and play out. Those are a couple of names that continue to flash.
Uh-oh. They're going to fake it. Vandy needs five. And the Commodores pick it up on the fake punt and a little trash talk afterwards.
Oh, just a direct snap.
Deshaun Jenkins with the run.
Jenkins, a safety, a direct snap. That's one of those things you see in film. You say, hey, we might have numbers. But, boy, I guess why not? You know, you're down three scores. Got to get some momentum somewhere.
I talked to Devin Fitzsimmons, the special teams coach, before the game. He said, I have two different ones I carry into every game. If it was up to me, of course, we'd run every game. He said, we got a defensive-minded head coach. He doesn't always like to do that.
Cole's the only one of us who's got a recent headshot. Here's Seals to throw. Pressured again. Gets touched from behind and dragged down, and lucky it wasn't picked up. It's Andre Anthony from his end spot. The senior from Endicar, New Orleans, is a wrecking crew in this one.
Man, one thing you're going to learn as a true freshman in this league, you get outside the pocket, don't get back inside the pocket. Don't head back in that direction. Nothing good happens back there, especially with the speed on the outside, as I mentioned, from Andre Anthony.
I want you to take us inside Ken Seal's head here. Starting against LSU, he's got one game under his belt as a college quarterback. You came in to Vanderbilt as a junior college transfer, so you had a little bit more seasoning. But you get right back out there with the offense after the fake punt. What can he do within this game to improve, to take a step?
I think play within the scheme, like I just mentioned. The thing I learned quickest was to slide. You start to fall back into these habits. You know, he was such a good player in high school. The success you have, the athletic moves you can make at that level, you can't do at this level. You can't run around people, and you learn that quickly. So getting the ball out on time is the biggest thing for a young quarterback. Make the right read and get the ball out on time. Don't take unnecessary sacks.
He got hit there as he threw, incomplete. Maurice Hampton Jr. in coverage for LSU, and that'll bring up fourth and eight. He might be thinking here. Yeah, he might be thinking, hey, guys, let's not fake this punt.
Yeah, I need a breather.
Let's get it back on defense. This will be the seventh Vanderbilt punt of the night. Fair catch from the 15. 4:15 to go in the third. Let's check out SEC news and notes. Oh, by the way, Georgia leads Auburn 24-6 at this point. Tennessee had 4 rushing touchdowns against Missouri today, most in a conference game in 4 seasons. Alabama hung 52 on A&M, and Kentucky a missed point after an overtime gave the Lane train its first win as Ole Miss's head coach.
How about Matt Corral? I've been impressed. I was one that was outspoken saying I thought John Rhys Plumlee needed the opportunity to grow as a passer and develop under Lane Kiffin. But I tell you what, Matt Corral has been something else. 300 yards again after doing it against Florida last week. Big reason they're being successful and beat Kentucky today.
Mac Jones had 3 touchdown passes of 60 yards or more. Complete to the tight end, Eric Gilbert. All right, we had another menu item on there about an Academy Award winner. Now, Eric Gilbert is from Marietta, Georgia, just like the Prince we were talking about a moment ago, and he's a product of Marietta High School. That might sound familiar to some folks who know entertainment, or at least sports. Now, Gilbert was a Gatorade Athlete of the Year last year. I mean, that's up there with guys like Peyton Manning and Kevin Love, LeBron. So let's play the guessing game. If you know the names, feel free to chime in. Marietta High School products, Gatorade National Player of the Year. I gave you that one. The first pick in the 2015 MLB draft came from the high school, same high school, as did the Academy Award winner for Best Actress in 1957. Anybody?
I don't know any bald actresses from 1957, so I'm going to avoid that one.
We'll show you the picture. That's not Yul Brynner.
That's got to be old Joanne Woodward, right?
Get out of here. Third and one, Brent into the slant. First down, LSU.
Cole, no phones. It's like trivia.
Oh, that's
Dansby Swanson is 2015. Yes, the wonderful Joanne Woodward.
You know her husband. Same as my wife.
She was a Kyle at LSU. Do you know who she was married to? Paul Newman. He wasn't just a great salad dressing guy, also fantastic actor in his own right. She was a drama major at LSU after growing up in Georgia and attending Marietta High School. Cole, if we could have added one more headshot, we would have dropped in Eric Zier.
No, he could swing it.
18 SEC records before he was done. Did you guys really think we would have the 1957 Academy Award winner for Best Actress in a football game?
I never put anything past you, Tom.
Well, if you know anything about Joanne, it makes sense.
Her mother was a fantastic actress, too. Got her interested in the theater at a young age. How do you go to LSU and not end up with the quarterback? That's my question. You end up with Paul Newman.
Not a bad alternative.
Well, get your bingo cards ready for next week. We got Mississippi State and Kentucky, and I don't know what else we can find, but we'll find something. By the way, Wynn Turner was the LSU quarterback in 1957. He was 16 for 41 all season. You got Joanne Woodward and Billy Cannon on campus at the same time. That's a pretty good era. Third and 10 now. LSU up by 20. Brennan over the middle. Complete. First down, LSU. Racy McMath. Gain of 22.
I love this here by Miles Brennan. Look, Ted Roof wanted to limit the quarterback's area of operation. Look, he does. Squeezes the pocket, but Brennan hangs in there and delivers an accurate throw. That's what you got to do from the quarterback position. Put everything that's going on around you out of your mind and zero in on your receiver. The best do it. Brennan's getting a lot better every snap I see.
Gives it up to Davis Pierce. Picks up 5 on first down. Cole, take us inside the pits. What does LSU's O-line look like in this one?
Looking better. I've noticed every highlight that Jordan has complimented Miles Brennan on a throw downfield. The pocket's been extremely clean. Also, using the tight end to vary the run game. I'll explain after this play.
Straight ahead again. And a big push from Price.
So you heard Jordan bring up earlier in the broadcast that essentially they were just an inside zone team last year, which is true. But you can utilize the tight end to visually deceive the linebackers and some of the defensive linemen. They'll insert him into the middle of the line and sort of follow him as a lead fullback. And they'll bring him across the line of scrimmage and run split zone as well, which will give the linebackers' eyes going a different direction.
Flea flicker. Brennan, watch it all. Deep ball down the middle. Touchdown, LSU. John Trey Kirkland from 29 yards out.
I love it. Roll the dice. Why not? You're already up big, but I love the flea flicker. Watch Brennan under pressure, moves a little bit to the right, still takes a hit, and a great toe tap at the end by Kirkland.
Incredible footwork for the former dual threat quarterback at Lutcher High School. Four touchdowns tonight through the air for Miles Brennan.
Again, just a subtle movement there by Brennan. He knew pressure was coming from the left. He moved to the right. Last week, he was moving in the pocket when he didn't need to. This week, very calculated with his movements. That's a marked improvement that usually doesn't happen that quick.
Cade York. Seconds left in the third. Let's get you to the studio.
You know, guys, it's not about age, it's about knowledge. And when you pay
it's
attention
to about how
to
quickly
things,
you can grab your phone and Google.
There's no way I could have Googled it in that amount of time.
I'm going to check the tape, Cole. We got camera four was probably on you. I'm checking the tape.
I took theater at Auburn, and I know these things.
You did not take theater.
My sister was a theater major at Auburn. I've had conversations with her.
Wait,
we
so
talked
theater
about these
didn't
things.
Take theater?
No,
just because your sister
theater.
Was in theater doesn't
I did
mean
take
you
organic
theater.
Gardening, but I did not take theater.
Just what? Because you've eaten a tub of popcorn at Regal Cinema does not mean
Hold
that
up.
You know anything about theater. By the way, since you do know Joanne Woodward so well, do you remember what movie she won the Academy Award for?
Oh, that's a ridiculous question. I don't even know why you would bring that up.
If we could get a camera on you quickly enough, we'd see your thumbs going to work. The Three Faces of Eve.
Hold up. Did we just gloss over the fact that the guy that was eating chicken fried bacon on TV last week said he took an organic gardening class?
Glad you brought that up.
You really
I knew some dudes in college that did some organic gardening. They were the ones with all the cash. No return. Let's take a look at the five-star play of the game. It's brought to you by Yellowwood.
A flea flicker, why not? Already up big. But just beautiful throw under pressure. And again, watch the toe tap. John Trey Kirkland, just one reception last week. One of those guys that's going to continue to grow into a big role. Because the LSU offense needs 3, 4, 5 of these guys to step up and be legitimate targets if they're going to be anything like they were last year.
I saw what you did there, talking about growing. Jamari Wakefield covers. Okay, Cole, you have a chance to explain. Did the ball come out? LSU took it away. And I'm going to say Wakefield was down. What other classes did you take at Auburn? And walk us through
the schedule. I thought you were going to talk about the counterplay where you had three guys coming downhill, kind of like the Three Faces of Eve right there.
What are
did
we
you
doing?
Say? Did you say organic gardening?
I did take organic gardening. Dr. James Brown at Auburn, yes. Had a pop quiz every Friday. Don't know why you called it a pop quiz, because you had one every Friday.
Kind of knew it was coming. Wakefield taken down in the backfield. Third quarter is over.
Get us to the real entertainment. This commercial. What are we doing? Organic gardening. Here's a commercial. Enjoy.
I'm tasting vanilla ice cream, Oreo cookie, the mini M&Ms, and the Snickers bar pieces.
And I take a bite, it's like, there it is! Mm-hmm. Oreo piece showed up to party and brought its friends.
The trick-or-treat blast. Party in my mouth.
Oh yeah.
We all have our own journey ahead of us, our own hopes and dreams. We'll pass many milestones, moments that define you and drive you to achieve even more. So celebrate everyone, because success isn't just about where you want to get to. It's also about how you get there.
And cut on rehearsal.
Welcome back to the Music City. 34-7 LSU on top as we head to the fourth quarter. After a slow start, LSU offense able to turn it on. And guys, after an adventurous start to our broadcast last weekend, I had to keep the bacon tour going. So stop by Bricktops today and picked up the Millionaire's Bacon. Had a couple of pieces just for you guys. Sorry I wasn't able to bring you down the field and have some for you in front of the camera. But did want to let you know that I was thinking about you. And I already got some tips on where to grab the best bacon in town next weekend.
Are you just going on a bacon tour of the South?
Southeastern Conference, yes.
Well, how many extra rides on your Peloton bike are you adding each week because of this increase in
it's
bacon?
Primal diet. We're going paleo, except for the syrup that was on
the
bacon.
Where does that bacon rank on the list? You had Acre last week.
Well, here's the first. We know that's going to be number one. And Tom knows this because there's a breakfast spot in College Station that also has Millionaire's Bacon. So I don't think you can be the best when multiple places have the same dish or at least name the same thing. So, but what I got a tip on for next week, oh, buddy, it looks good.
How much does a plate of Millionaire's Bacon cost?
I think it was like $4.75, something like that.
You should expense it since we got it into the show.
I will hand that receipt over to my wife for when she turns those in.
Oh, interesting. Can't do your own paperwork. It's amazing you passed organic gardening.
Yeah, didn't pass keyboarding, but organic gardening did make it pass.
What kind of classes did you... Jeez. They called it, you got a degree for keyboarding and organic chemistry?
And I mean, actually, sorry, communication was the degree, Jordan. We didn't have a keyboarding was not a major at Auburn when I was there. Show you how you do things here in Nashville.
Javion Marlowe's got a lot of work tonight, guys. Junior from Winter Haven, Florida. He was a three-star recruit. Only 8 games last year. First down now by Marlowe. Vanderbilt, I feel like... this is just a summation, but when they've been good, they've had a reliable back. And when they get a reliable back, they tend to lean on that guy a lot more than other programs have.
Yeah. I mean, at Vanderbilt, you have to slow the football game down. You have to start running the football. We were good doing that back in the day. But it's been tough for Vanderbilt. They had all their offensive line, or a big chunk of their offensive line, opt out, you know, before the season, so they really didn't have the preparation that they needed. They've had to do a lot more good on good. They've limited certain sessions during training. And also Keon Brooks being out this week, he's a running back for them, one of their more explosive guys. Devin Boddy on the outside, two of their fastest, most explosive guys out today as well.
Defense number 24, 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, automatic first down.
Derek Stingley Schumann after all.
And Seals wanted to get one on him. Yeah, early contact, doesn't find the ball. It's pass interference.
There goes the Heisman. They go the end around. And Vandy's going to have a huge run here down the sideline by Jaden Harris and Kirk Herbstreit. Had Stingley on his Heisman list to begin the season. Pick up.
I mean,
15.
What would it take? What would it take for a defensive guy to win the Heisman, especially defensive back? You're not getting the sacks or probably as many tackles, but what's the over-under on interceptions you need to win the Heisman?
He has one part of it, though, in that he returns punts. I think you have to be involved in special teams.
Flag on the play, shot to the end zone incomplete. I think it would be wonderful if he got an opportunity on the offensive side of the ball, maybe just a short playlist, right? But he's going to have to come up huge in the biggest games.
Number 92 is in the neutral zone. 5-yard penalty. First down.
I mean, we saw today what Alabama's receivers can do, play after play, and Derek Stingley's just one guy in that LSU secondary, but that's who LSU will measure themselves against again this year. Alabama put up 52 today. Jaylen Waddle had 142 yards. Bet she had 5 catches for a 181 and 2 touchdowns.
Mac Jones is going to get himself in that conversation for the Heisman the way he's playing. Like, I mean, Alabama's balanced. Najee Harris is one of the best backs in the country. Their defense is better this year. And Mac Jones has picked up right where he left off last year.
Seals going to the corner of the end zone up against the wall. And out of our view, incomplete. Chris Pierce, the intended receiver.
How about those Vandy helmets? Didn't say anything about those yet.
Old school script. Yeah.
Love it.
With the Nashville skyline on the back. The only football team in Nashville playing this weekend, right? Titans on shutdown. Even the soccer team going through some COVID protocols. Jamari Wakefield with the carry. We had a great talk with Derek Mason about how they dealt with that throughout the fall, getting ready for the season, and the benefit they have by being attached to one of the great medical centers in the entire country.
Yeah, they test a lot. I mean, student body and faculty all get tested once a week. Obviously, the football team and the sports teams test very frequently. Sure helps having that resource literally a few buildings over from where the football facility is.
Keeper and Mike Wright gets taken down. Mason mentioned, he said, listen, we had EKGs, cardiac MRIs. We knew about myocarditis. We have elite level information, and it helps. We're keeping our parents up to date, Zoom calling them on a regular basis. It was interesting when all the myocarditis news was breaking throughout college football and people were acting like it was something new. Seems like all the SEC schools, like, we've known about that for years, and we've been testing for a long time. Seals pressured, end zone shot. It is intercepted. LSU with the takeaway, Todd Harris Jr., and his convoy will help him get past the 20.
I said it earlier. True freshman quarterback, the one thing you got to do is get the ball out on time. Seals hangs a little too long, and against LSU, you can't hang and throw the ball late over the middle. LSU building on a big lead.
We live in uncertain times. However, there is one thing you can be certain of.
Morning, everybody.
The men and women of the United States Postal Service. We are here to deliver your cards, packages, and prescriptions. And also deliver the peace of mind knowing that what's important to you, like your ballot, is on its way. Every day, all across America, we deliver for you. And we always will.
Experience the Xfinity Sports Zone, where you can find games, news, and highlights all in one place, right on your TV. Now that's simple, easy, awesome. Click, call, or visit a store for details.
All right, you got some choices. Southern, mild, medium, hot, dang hot, and shut the cluck up. Those are the spice choices at Hattie B's Chicken. Jordan, what do you go with?
I go with medium because it'll burn your face off. And I've tried the shut the cluck up, and I've tried just a little tiny piece, and I don't think I could taste anything for about a week and a half. But dang, it's good. Love
John Emery Jr. with the carry. Yeah, a lot of food choices when you go to Nashville. You said that that's not the only choice for hot chicken, though. You've got some others that you...
You got to go find Prince's. That's the original. And when you go there, what's funny, they won't let you order hot. They don't have to fancy all these levels. They have mild, medium, and hot. And they don't let you order the hot unless they know you. We went in there, my brother loves hot stuff, my brother Luke, and he's like, I'll take the hot. And she goes, honey, I don't know you. I'm going to give you the medium.
No way.
Oh, yeah.
It's like walking into a mafia spot. You have to be a friend of ours.
Oh, yeah. I guess they're protecting you. They don't want you suing them or getting angry because it's too hot or whatever. But that's the hole in the wall play. That's the OG hot chicken.
Defense number six. The penalty will place the ball at the spot of the foul and includes an automatic first down.
I learned the story of the origination of hot chicken this week. I'd never heard it before. And it was actually originally intended for a husband who was cheating on his wife, and she made him dinner when she found out, and she was so mad, she loaded up the chicken with all these hot spices thinking that she was gonna get back at him. He loved it. He said, well, this is the best chicken you've ever made. Lo and behold, a delicacy was born. That's the story of James Gordon Prince, as you mentioned, Princess.
Jordan, Thornton. Jordan, your spot open late night? Asking for a friend.
I don't know, actually. But you Google Academy Award-winning actresses, so why don't you just hop on the Google machine?
I don't even have a phone down here.
Run straight ahead. It's John Emery again. And Emery takes it to the 45, a pickup of 11. 10 minutes to go in this one. What can we take from LSU's performance week to week from Mississippi State to this Vandy game?
Well, I think they got better at a lot of different positions. Obviously, the defense is a given. Getting Derek Stingley back, that's a given. But offensively, Brennan took a big step. And more importantly, I think they've showed they can run the football. Look, I mean, Vanderbilt, they're not flashy, but they're stout up front. They corralled Texas A&M last week. And I saw John Emery in place of a Chris Curry, guy that didn't get a lot of action last year, show some flash, show some burst. And they didn't have to be too creative. It was still a lot of inside zone. Yes, a few differences with the tight end, but this ground game got going, and that's what they're going to need as they get into stiffer competition down the road to balance out this potent passing attack.
300-yard passing game for Miles Brennan. LSU correcting their mistakes. Only fair that we correct ours. And apologies to Ingrid Bergman, who won Best Actress in 1957. Joanne Woodward won it in 1958.
Trying to tell you guys.
Jeez, Tom.
Joanne Woodward, by the way, the oldest living Academy Award winner. Ingrid Bergman and Yul Brynner, the twofer in 57. Torrey Carter in at tight end for LSU, number 44. On second and 10, linebackers coming. Brennan able to get it off, looking for a screen. And a slip for Kayshawn Boutte, and he's down inside the 15. Freshman out of Westgate High School, New Iberia.
Look at big Ed Ingram, number 70, the left guard, getting back out there. We saw him bust open a couple guys on the first screen, and he's not supposed to be out front there, but look at that. He's the last one down there by Boutte, finishing it off.
By who?
Cole, what's it like for an offensive lineman to get out in the open field?
Love it.
Like, you don't get a little nervous, missile, a little tight, all that grass.
Here's Emery, touchdown LSU. And a finger roll. A little George Gervin salute. 12-yard touchdown run, John Emery Jr. He's over 100 yards. LSU rolling with 8:11 to play.
Again, just a little outside zone. Cole, what'd they do down there?
A stretch play to the outside is one where obviously John Emery Jr. can utilize his speed to be able to bounce to the outside. Got a good block from the wide receiver out near the goal line as well. And you mentioned it, Jordan, run game continuing to pick up for LSU, a confidence growing, not only with the run game, but the entire offense.
Cade York. Thanks. Sophomore from St. Rose, Louisiana, John Emery Jr. rolling tonight.
The You've Been Dreaming About This Car Since You Were 8 policy from American Family Insurance.
Searching for meaning in a relentless world. Always connected, but somehow alone. Trapped by illusion. We offer another path where the battle to belong begins. Awakened by a calling. United by the cause you fight for. No one can take away what it means to be among the few, the proud, the Marines.
Time to take a look at our 15 minutes or less, brought to you by Geico.
It's been the ground game, it's been through the air. Everything for LSU has been working, and a couple unknowns, right? Jontre Kirkland, a guy we didn't know a ton about. We knew a lot about Terrace Marshall. He had a few as well. But Miles Brennan has been sharp. LSU has rebounded. Not that they needed to rebound much on offense, but defensively they've rebounded. And the best thing that has come from tonight is this ground game for LSU, and specifically John Emery. He's been brilliant.
130 yards on the ground as a team. Emery 12 carries for a 103. And Brennan through the air, 324. Probably talking organic gardening over there. Donovan Kaufman back out of Archbishop Rummel in New Orleans. And he'll take it out from a couple yards deep. Full head of steam in a hole, and he gets popped past the 25. Let's take you back to the studio. Here's Dari. You guys see that one coming?
No.
I did not.
Stetson Bennett the fourth, the initials at the end of his name, also represented where he was on the depth chart. Juggling takeaway, and LSU's got another one. This belongs to Eli Ricks. Second pick of the season for Ricks.
Oh, this is great to see, because Eli Ricks got, I mean, to put it nicely, he got abused last week. I mean, he got throws over him. He struggled in man coverage, but, I mean, he's a talented young true freshman, a former five-star. So no doubt he was capable of making these plays. And I love to see rebound, some confidence, get slaps on the helmet from his teammates. He had a rough week last week. But that'll happen in this league. For him to come back, get an interception like that, great positioning there and a great play on the ball.
Bo Pelini said communication among my guys was a big disappointment and something that they were missing throughout that game, where they got torched for an SEC record performance by KJ Costello and the air raid. Brennan keeps it and he picks up three. Miles Brennan really want to be running the ball in a 41-7 game in the fourth quarter?
No, Tom.
Dynamite drop in, second and seven. Incomplete. I'm excited to see. We got Mississippi State, Kentucky next week to kind of dig into the air raid. We learned how not to defend the air raid last week from LSU. It seemed like Bo Pelini's defense was uber aggressive. Ed Ogeron said, yeah, there were some adjustments that we simply did not make. And they got exotic at times in how they were attacking Mississippi State. And it's like Mike Leach is the chess player at the park that's playing for money. He knows how to answer every move that you make, even before you make it, it seems. Brennan to the outside. Great catch. It'll leave fourth and a few. Adams with the grab. LSU getting deep into their roster.
Again, in that no man's land position. Too deep for a field goal. Don't really want to punt when you're rolling. Hand the ball off, try to pick up one.
Fourth and one. Brennan to throw to the slant, and that's caught for an LSU first down.
Or, you know what, don't listen to me. Throw the quick slant here.
I mean,
I think
listen.
That last check, he looked to the sidelines twice. I think that second one, they saw what they liked and had the confidence in Brennan. Let's go.
As great as Clyde Edwards-Helaire was last year and has been for the Chiefs so far this season, LSU got to a point where Joe Burrow's accuracy was such that the passing game was seemingly just as safe as the run game.
I mean, when you're completing almost 80% of your throws, it is. I mean, as an offensive coordinator, you don't have to worry about negative plays. You trust your quarterback implicitly that even if the big shot's not there, he's going to find a completion, and positive plays, even if it's just 1 yard and a completion, make things so much easier for an offensive coordinator to continue dialing up shot plays like that. So Brennan's got some of that in him. He's extremely accurate. As the confidence and the knowledge grows, that's going to grow as well.
Timeout taken by Vandy. LSU leading. There's 48 points on the board with 5:20 to go.
Searching for meaning in a relentless world, always connected, but somehow alone, trapped by illusion. We offer another path, where the battle to belong begins. Awakened by a calling, united by the cause you fight for, no one can take away what it means to be among the few, the proud, the Marines.
Grab Taco Bell's Nachos Party Pack whenever you're dressing up to stay in or witnessing a miracle. Go big with delicious nachos topped with all your favorites. Nachos Party Pack, only at Taco Bell. Get yours with Taco Bell delivery.
Well, we're not able to be there this week, but Nashville is always one of our favorite trips. And whether it's Bluebird Cafe or Mercy Lounge, so many great live music places that don't have fans watching. That changes tonight. Dierks Bentley, Terry Clark, Vince Gill, and Lori Morgan on hand to perform. They've gone 4,944 consecutive Saturdays since Saturday, November 1925, with live music at the Grand Ole Opry. Jordan, how many? You've been to the Grand Ole Opry a couple times?
Yeah, no better place to watch music. Probably my favorite place in all of Nashville. Now, Tom, I'm going to say something that's a little unpopular. I think it's a slightly overrated.
Wow.
I mean, look, I love the history, and you got to go see it. But if you really want to go see music, go to the Ryman. I mean, you will never experience a more intimate venue. Saw George Strait there. I mean, it's unbelievable. The exit in down in Midtown's a great spot as well. There's a great number of hole-in-the-wall places. See the Opry, but there's a lot of other places as well to explore. Not dogging on it too bad.
I'm not going to crush you on that, and I haven't been to those other places you mentioned, but maybe you just didn't do the Opry properly.
Totally. Totally.
And that's where I did it right. Our friend Kaylee Hartung got us backstage at the Opry. Rascal Flatts, Little Big Town. Charles Esten was playing that night. And so were my guys, High Valley. And to sit in a musician's dressing room and hear them play with other musicians popping in and say, hey, man, what are you jamming to? And just pull out a guitar and play, that's the way to do the opera.
Okay, yeah, but not all of us are Tom Hart. Not all of us get the backstage access like that, okay, Tom? I'm sure I would have loved it, too.
We'll do it next time. If we get back to Nashville, if we're allowed to travel.
unlike Cole.
Big offensive lineman just still moving dudes around at this point. And they're getting a chance to play some guys. Austin Deculus picking himself off the ground. Cameron Wire got the start at left tackle in this one today.
Yeah, don't like to see Ed Ingram limping off the field, though.
No. Joe Moore Award winners last year. The best offensive line in college football. Got a ways to go after losing talent to the next level.
They're going to get man coverage here. They're going to take another shot?
Oh. They'll keep it on the ground. And Josh Williams with the carry off the right side.
I mean, I expected, right? Fourth and one, they throw the ball. You get man coverage down here in the red zone.
Third down, three. 48 points scored in this one. 41 of them belong to LSU. Straight ahead. It's Williams again. First down, LSU. Stepped on a pop top, must have blown out his flip flop. Josh Williams still trying to get his heel inside his cleats. It's folded under. Here's his handoff. And he got bounced off one to the outside. A pickup of a yard. A lot of folks out there would love even a field goal on this final drive for LSU. Let's see if they try to punch it in with a 110 and counting. Straight ahead. And that will leave third and goal. Well, that should do it. Play clock just a hair behind the game clock, and LSU won't have to get another snap off if they don't want to. It looks like Miles Brennan wants to, and they'll take a knee. And victory formation for LSU. The Tigers will even their record to 1-1 and send Vandy to an 0-2 start in this SEC-only schedule of 10 games for each side. Bounce-back performance for LSU and a 41-7 victory. Jordan, what impressed you the most?
I think it was the balance. The balance on offense for LSU. They were able to run the football. John Emery looked unbelievable. Really did. Against a defense in Vanderbilt that is formidable. It's not a bad defense that he was up against. And then just to see LSU's defense in the secondary rebound the way they did. I expected them to, but good to see after a rough week against Mississippi State last week.
We've got more coverage coming your way from Music City. LSU 41-7 over Vanderbilt as the head coaches meet at midfield. Ninth straight win for LSU over Vandy.
Gear up for fall at Academy Sports and Outdoors.
On a night,
about this car since you were 8 policy from American Family Insurance. Insure carefully. Dream fearlessly.
20th-ranked LSU takes care of Vanderbilt after a relatively slow first quarter. The Tigers pull it on and run away from the Vanderbilt Commodores. LSU now 1-1 on the season. Our final score, once again, LSU 41, Vanderbilt 7. Coming up next, SEC Football Final, presented by Academy Sports and Outdoors. So long from Nashville. Dari, it is all yours.